The Philippine Trade Department recently concluded a business mission in Osaka, Japan to boost Philippine-Japanese economic ties. There, they launched the ASEAN-Japan Business Platform. It's a joint initiative led by commerce groups from both countries. The Osaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry and the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry also inking a deal aimed at providing channels for business cooperation and supporting over 30,000 small businesses in the Osaka Prefecture. Japan stands as one of the most significant sources of investments for the Philippines, contributing to 21 realized projects out of the 148 investment projects recorded by the DTI last year. The Philippine Ports Authority is set to remit over 5 billion pesos in dividends, marking its highest contribution to the national treasury since its creation in 1974 at 5.05 billion pesos. This is equivalent to 58.25% of PPA's net earnings for 2023. The agency bagged 25.4 billion in revenues last year. That's up 24%. All in all, PPA ranked fourth in terms of dividend contributions to government last year, beating even PCSO, PNOC, and Clark Development Corporation. More reclamation projects in Manila Bay are seen to get the green light over the next several months, less than a year after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. ordered their suspension, pending further review on their environmental impact. The details from Andrea Taguines.
The Philippine Reclamation Authority is eyeing the resumption of two more reclamation projects in Manila Bay within the quarter or the next. These are the 90-hectare reclamation project in Bacoor, Cavite, and the nearly 16-hectare reclamation project by the Philippine Fisheries Development Authority in Navotas, which seeks to expand the city's fish port in a bid to boost food security.
We're expecting a, siyempre, categorical go signal from DNR and the Office of the President. I think tapos na rin po yung kanilang evaluation and investigation, and siguro soon we would get a written recommendation na for the lifting up the suspension sa two projects.
Back in August last year, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. ordered the suspension of all reclamation projects in Manila Bay and asked the Environment Department to conduct a cumulative impact assessment. That's after environmental groups raised the alarm on the damage that reclamation projects will cause to marine habitats, as well as to coastal communities that rely on the sea for their livelihood. Out of the 16 projects that were suspended, so far only two have been allowed to continue by the DENR: the 265-hectare Pasay Harbor City Reclamation Project and the SM Prime Reclamation Project, which is also located in Pasay City.
Ang target completion po is December 2025. There's an ordinance ng Pasay right now na no new casinos would be developed within reclamation project. So ang target po nito ngayon are new businesses, universities, first class universities, first class hospitals.
The PRA hopes the 148-hectare Manila Solar City and the 650-hectare Navotas Coastal Bay Reclamation and Development Project will also be green-lighted this year, noting the economic gains they would bring to the country. Literal said it would also further raise the PRA's asset value, which is currently at 150 billion pesos.
Reclamation at conversion!
Meanwhile, fisher folk group Pamalakaya has complained about ongoing dredging activities in Cavite despite the suspension of the reclamation project there. But Literal explained such activities are not under the PRA's control.
Nakakabahala yung ganito, no? Sa kabila, wala pa namang, di pa naman nililip, no? Suspension order at hindi pa nilalabas.
Yung dredging activity sa Cavite, nahati yun sa dalawa eh. One is for PRA reclamation projects and the other one is for the Bulacan Airport. So hindi covered ng suspension yung sa Bulacan Airport because they're not classified as reclamation projects within Manila Bay. The ECC itself stated that it's a land development project. Yun po yung nagko-continue.
Literal also guaranteed assistance for thousands of fisherfolk families in Bacoor and other sectors who will be directly and indirectly affected if and once the reclamation activities begin. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Stock Exchange optimistic at least two companies out of the targeted six will make their market debut this year. Citicore Renewable Energy Corp and mining company Oceana Gold seen listing soon. PSE President Ramon Monzon hopes programs such as PSE's Listing Engagement and Assistance Program for companies exploring the prospects of IPO listing will decide to take the leap. Among those looking at the possibility of listing, more real estate investment trusts and gaming names.
Six, if they're going to push through, I don't know. But I think most of them will. If a few of them won't, there will be other ones that hindi ko pa alam. Maybe we have 20 lip clients here. Baka may tatlo, apat dito sana makonvince natin mag-list. The year started off very well, no? You can see like what Miguel was saying. So with a strong market, hopefully those that have been waiting, everyone say, we're waiting for a good time. Maybe this is a good time. Sabi nga ni Jose Verano, maganda na kayo. Tsaka na kayo mag-desisyon. Prepare the groundwork na.
SM Investments, which just posted a 25% jump in their 2023 earnings on healthy consumer spending, warns against the proposed increase in the minimum wage. And as Jackie Pascual tells us, the group is now targeting to expand its non-core businesses to help fuel growth. Take a look.
One of the country's largest conglomerates speaks up about the proposed wage hike for minimum wage workers. SM Investments Corporation, parent company of the SM Malls and BDO, among others, says a 100 or 350 peso wage hike will affect the company and the economy. It adds the effect would likely hit consumers.
It will definitely have an impact on the GDP growth. It could have an impact as well on inflationary pressures. That will affect primarily the minimum wage workers, right? I don't know what number we have, but I think the bulk of our employees are actually higher than minimum wage. But again, it will help, well, it will obviously increase the operating cost, right? So the question is that how much of that increasing cost can you actually pass on to your customer.
But one of its consultants offers another perspective.
There's one other aspect to increasing wages, which is that you increase the spending power of the average Filipino consumer who is receiving more wages.
The group says they are on a wait-and-see mode to see the final outcome of the proposed measure, which is being discussed in Congress. But D. Bunshu remains confident 2024 will be a good year for the group as they seek the expansion of their portfolio investments or non-core businesses like To-Go, Airspeed, and its renewable energy unit.
We bought two new ships in December and January, and we're looking to acquire another one. Okay, because we really believe that the growth is there, right? And the warehouses, we have warehouses nationwide. And more importantly, we have close to 3,000 retail outlets as well nationwide.
He says they're looking to invest more in logistics and energy projects.
To-Go has actually turned around very nicely over the past 2 years. Our geothermal business, we right now our operations is limited to two assets, one in TV, one in Macban, but we do have six other concessions which we're planning to develop.
SMIC's net income in 2023 grew 25% to 77 billion pesos, with its banking unit contributing a big chunk to that growth. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. addressed the Parliament of Australia, becoming the first Philippine leader to do so. During his speech, Marcos underscored the strong relations between the two countries, especially in terms of defense. Marcos says Canberra and Manila's military alliance is essential as the region faces geopolitical threats in the South China Sea. The Philippines and Australia have agreed last year to elevate their relations to a strategic partnership.
Our strategic partnership has grown more important than ever. We must reinforce each other's strengths. We must protect the peace that we fought for during the war and have jealously guarded in the decades since. We must oppose actions that clearly denigrate the rule of law. As in 1942, the Philippines now finds itself on the front line against actions that undermine regional peace, erode regional stability, and threaten regional success. Then as now, we remain firm in defending our sovereignty, our sovereign rights, our jurisdiction. I shall never tire of repeating the declaration that I made from the first day that I took office. I will not allow any attempt by any foreign power to take even one square inch of our sovereign territory.
Marcos also touched on the issues of clean energy and climate change, saying the Philippines remains one of the most vulnerable countries to climate disasters. He also noted opportunities to collaborate in renewable energy and mineral exploration.
My administration is committed to accelerating our just, affordable, sustainable, and inclusive energy transition towards carbon neutrality. The Philippines has the potential to be a net carbon sink, absorbing more carbon dioxide than we emit. Yet, we are one of the most climate vulnerable countries in the world, ranking first in the 2023 World Risk Index. This glaring disproportion between our share of responsibility and our vulnerability reflects an injustice that must be corrected. Developed countries must do more, and they must do it now. And as members of the Pacific family.
Marcos will be in Australia twice in a span of 1 week. While he will return to Manila today, he'll be flying back to Australia on March 4th to attend the ASEAN-Australia Special Summit in Melbourne. And Swifties, listen up. A Philippine lawmaker wants Singapore to explain a reported exclusivity clause that barred pop superstar Taylor Swift from performing anywhere else in Southeast Asia. Joy Salceda requested the Foreign Affairs Department to send a note verbal to the Singaporean embassy over that matter. Salceda claims some $3 million in grants were allegedly given by the Singapore government to exclusively host the much-anticipated concert in its country. This, he says, resulted to a boom in Singapore's economic activity, but at the expense of neighboring countries. For Salceda, the move runs contrary to the principle of consensus-based relations and solidarity on which the ASEAN was founded. Swift will be performing 6 sold-out shows at Singapore's National Stadium starting March 2nd.